People, you know, climb Everest. I think for some people, it's this quest for identity and for meaning. For others, it's like the height of what they regard as physical achievement. And for me, my reason was since I was a young boy, my dad had given me a picture of Everest. He'd been the man who taught me to climb at a young age, and it had been a huge dream of ours together. And that's what I grew up longing and yearning to do, and that was always my focus as a kid. It was what I was good at. You know, I wasn't always great at school or whatever, but I was good at climbing, and Everest became the symbol of that for me.
I was young, but even then I knew you gotta show the mountain the utmost respect.
I'm as nervous as I've ever been, really. We're just sort of drinking and trying to eat before we set off on the final bit. Gotta sort of put our old things on and just sort of plod a step at a time and pray for a safe, you know, up and down and then home and then families and stuff.
Some 10 years later, I had a real urge to go back and try and achieve a proper Everest first. So together with my buddy Gilo, we returned to the mountain to attempt to fly powered paragliders over the summit.
I was about to find out that flying to the top of the world isn't easy either. One of the problems is wind deflecting off the faces, creating deadly air turbulence. And worse, Everest is tall enough to intercept the 300 kilometers an hour winds of the infamous jet stream.
You can hear it hitting Everest. You can be at base camp and you can hear. It sounds like an express train.
Not a sensible place to take to the skies.
Well, at the time, the world record for paragliding was about 20,000 feet, so we were effectively trying to go almost half as high again, so it was always going to be ambitious.
OK, man, bad luck.
Gilo had actually designed and built the paramotor engines, but when his failed and I saw him starting to descend, leaving me alone, there was definitely a real sense of, you know, pit of my stomach nerves at that point. It's the same as climbing, you know, above 8,000 meters, really you need oxygen. But when you're flying a paraglider, if something happens to that oxygen system and it freezes, you're in a lot of trouble because you're unconscious and that parachute is still flying. You fly into the mountains, you're dead. And it's that mix of intense excitement, but also aware that at this point, you're still very, very vulnerable.
I kept pushing up and up until I was certain I'd become the first to paraglide higher than the summit.
It was amazing to be the first person in a paraglider to look down and see Everest beneath me, but I wasn't the first person who tried to fly that high.
April 1933. Two open cockpit biplanes make their way towards the summit. Led by RAF squadron leader Douglas Hamilton, they'd already flown 250 kilometers from Pune in northern India. They're here to make a detailed survey of the Himalayan mountains, so they have cameras on board. But these are so heavy, they've had to forego their parachutes.
People have always wanted first on Everest, and flying over Everest would have been a first.
Flying in formation at 10:05 in the morning, the planes reach 8,990 meters and skim over the peak with just 150 meters clearance. A world first, which made pilots Hamilton and McIntyre famous overnight.
Did you get there?
20 years later, their photographs of the peak would guide Edmund Hillary and Tenzing Norgay to the summit. Seventy-one years on, Italian Angelo Dorigo, a.k.a. the Human Condor, attempts to repeat the feat in something a little more flimsy, a hang glider. Scientists have told Angelo that it would be impossible to survive the flight, even with full oxygen systems and modern clothing.
Credo che da quando l'uomo pensa ha sempre voluto e cercato di imitare il volo, ossia il volo vero, quello degli uccelli. Per me l'Everest dentro, sulla parete, sopra, è il simbolo del massimo degli spazi che l'essere umano può avere nella sua dimensione. Per questo voglio fare l'Everest.
Towed up by a microlite, he was released at 9,000 meters, higher than the summit.
Sogno da ragazzino, quando ho iniziato a capire.
Everything was going well until he was close to the peak. With temperatures 50 degrees below, Angelo flies straight into a pocket of turbulence that threatens to tear his glider apart. He recovers control, crosses the summit, but the weather turns. He can't head back to his landing strip and needs to find somewhere to land now before thick cloud obscures everything. Angelo finds a plateau, a relatively flat land. But coming in at 100 kilometers an hour, he has little time to slow down. He takes his hands off the steering bar so they won't get mangled in the impact. He's earned two broken ribs and one broken record. He's a lucky man. But tragically, his luck doesn't last. 2 years after his daring flight, Angelo was killed in an air crash in Italy. Argentina-born Everest veterans, the Benegas brothers, are heading down exhausted after 6 days of hard, technical climbing.
Some Sherpas came and asked some help to bring down one of their friend, Karma Sherpa.
Karma is suffering from altitude sickness. They need to get him down quickly if they're to have any chance of saving his life.
It was a very technical, very challenging rescue, especially once we reach the area of Camp 1. We encounter one of the first of many big crevasses. Here, we have to make a decision, either bring him down in the crevasse or set up a zip line.
The makeshift stretcher starts to twist, threatening to throw Karma into the crevasse. Without thinking or clipping into a safety line, Damien jumps onto the ropes.
Things needed to get done, and we get it done. I remember jumping on the rope. No safety clip, just incredible danger.
One false move could see him killed too.
We were young, we didn't know that much. We didn't have that much of self-preservation, I guess.
After 16 hours of struggle, they are almost at base camp and medical help.
Later that night at 3 o'clock in the morning, we decided to stop for a second to check on him. We realized he was unconscious, so we proceeded on CPR. And sadly enough, he passed away.
They've done all they can, but Karma doesn't make it.
For me, it was really, really hard, that experience.
My life was actually saved by two of the icefall doctors when I climbed on Everest. It was early on in the expedition, and I was descending from Camp 1, crossing what had been just solid snow and ice. And I remember taking a step, and as I put the weight forward, I just saw this crack in the ice go straight under me. There was a second pause. I grabbed a rope, clipped in. Literally, as that carabiner went over that rope, the ground just went. I ended up just dropping, and an ice came down, knocked me out. I remember smashing into the side of the ice and coming to and looking up and just seeing this rope above me, and on the end of it were two Sherpas and Mick, who I was climbing with. And the truth is, if it wasn't for those guys on the end of that rope, you know, I wouldn't be here today. So my life was saved by those guys. They were brilliant people, just like so many of the Sherpas.